This is Opal. It's one of the world's most beautiful and valuable precious gems. It can be worth up to 10 times the weight of gold. Since Roman times, it has been prized as the queen of gems, bestowing magical virtues and good fortune on its owners. But the earth doesn't yield up such a prize easily. It's hidden in the bowels of some of the world's harshest land. On the surface, there is an average rainfall of 150 millimeters a year, and summer temperatures averaging 36 degrees. Beneath the surface lies the world's largest and richest known deposits of opal. This is Coober Pedy. It's one of the last places on Earth where a man can find his fortune overnight. The chances of striking it rich are slim. Perhaps only one of these holes paid off with the jackpot. But that man could call himself a millionaire. Coober Pedy is isolated in the middle of a desert. It's in the north of South Australia, halfway between Adelaide and Alice Springs. Above ground, there's not much to see. The town of about 5,000 people has grown up haphazardly around the site of the first opal mines. The buildings don't look as if their owners plan to stay long. Tracks and roads crisscross each other erratically. Only the main street is bitumen. There are two ways of reaching Coober Pedy. A dusty, monotonous 1,000 kilometer drive from the nearest large city, Adelaide, or a 2-hour flight by light aeroplane. The name Coober Pedy comes from the Aboriginal word for boy's waterhole. It was their way of describing the white men they saw digging in holes. The most civilized aspect of the town lies below the surface, in its well-known underground homes, or dugouts. They're excavated into the sides of the low hills of the Stuart Ranges. Some have been made from abandoned mines. Outside, it might be as hot as 45 degrees or as cold as 4 degrees Celsius. But inside, it'll be a pleasant 21 to 26 degrees.
There's a few working right across the other side of the road now.
Yeah, that's what I said to Jim the other day. I said they're on the wrong side of the road, mate. Why not?
The soft rock can be safely excavated into large rooms. Extending your house is simple. You only need a pick and a strong back. The extensions might also pay for themselves. Much valuable opal still lies beneath the town boundaries. Mining is forbidden because of the problems of noise and safety. Ivan Radica's not looking for opal. He's after a more risk-free income. The new rooms are for his underground motel and youth hostel. Putting up the walls, ceiling and floor of this ensuite bathroom is relatively inexpensive. He even digs out his own building blocks. However, the materials for finishing the job are expensive, because of the high transport costs. More recent arrivals to Coober Pedy are Jim Reynolds and his wife, Chris. They bought a dugout and are now settled into the routine of opal mining. Jim swapped a steady job with an insurance company in the city for the chance of finding his fortune in Coober Pedy. Jim struck up a partnership with a more established miner, Jim Cunningham. Mining today is made easier with machinery, such as air-driven drills and jack picks. While Jimmo drills holes for the charges, his partner Jim Cunningham prepares the explosives. They mix their own because it's cheaper than using gelignite. The shots are placed carefully so they will blow a hole underneath the level of opal-bearing dirt. It's always a tense moment. One set of charges can suddenly reveal a seam of glittering opal, or just leave another pile of rubble to clear away. Both men are keen to look at the face. The jackpick eats into the level, revealing only pieces of milky, valueless potch, with only a hint of colour. Potch is actually opal, but without the mysterious arrangements of crystals which create the colours of precious opal. Miners call this beggar's opal.
Beggar's opal. So there's always the chance, you know, the next shot, it'll change, you know, the ground will be do the right thing.
Jimmo is still optimistic, but his partner has followed too many leads like this before. With each charge, they seem to be finding less and less traces of colour. Before placing another set of charges, the loose rubble has to be cleared from the mine. Jim Cunningham owns a blower. It's a giant vacuum cleaner, invented in Coober Pedy by the ever-resourceful miners, looking for easier and quicker ways to remove the dirt. The pipe quickly sucks the rubble the 20 metres to the surface. The running costs of the blowers are high because they run on diesel oil. If you're not finding enough opal, you need some capital or other income to keep going, especially if you've got a young family like Jimmo. To supplement his income, Jimmo works at night at the bar of the Italian club.
Like
His two workmates, Dave and Joey, are also opal miners, working for expense money. Their costs, however, are a lot smaller. Not so long ago, this was the way most mining was done in Coober Pedy. The dirt is hauled to the surface in buckets by a small motorized winch, called a York hoist. It's the cheapest way to mine, but it's also the slowest and the hardest on the back. Once at the face, all mining technique is the same. The hand pick is best to gently prise out the opal. If these pieces of potch turned into good colour, Joey and Dave could forget working at the bar. Opal mining is likely to stay the domain of the individual miners. The law only allows one claim per person, and the risks are too high to make it worthwhile for large mining companies. But there is a less risky way of finding opal in Coober Pedy, and it's not such hard work. Tourists visiting Ivan Radica's motel are able to experience the ultimate Coober Pedy experience, the thrill of finding your own opal.
Anyway, before we go down into the mine, of course, we need some tools. A wonderful virus. If anybody wants them, they cost you only $1 each.
Ivan has learnt the art of showmanship.
You never know in this country. This is a funny country, Coober Pedy. You never know where the fortune is lying. Okay, anyway, I'm going first, and if you just follow me.
Ivan's dugout was the first in Coober Pedy. Underneath, he has preserved a section of an old mine.
I'm going to explain you how we go about mining, what we do, and how we make big money here in this town. Now, first of all, when a miner goes looking for opal, he must recognize the right kind of ground. If he's not on the right ground, he has no hope of getting any opal. Now, this is what the miner has to know. He must know his ground. That's the most important. Now, it's not the quantity of opal you find, it's the quality what it means. If you find good quality opal, well, you're right in money. If you get $5,000 an ounce, you need only a bucket full, you have $1 million in. In one bucket full of good quality opal, you have $1 million. If you look at the pocket of opal, you pull out that pocket, you think that there was never any opal. You hit a pocket, you see opal color everywhere. You think that's all full of opal, never finishes. You see everything red, everything most wonderful sight when you see a nice pocket of opal running across.
Oh, I'd just like to see it without owning it.
Yeah. Believe it or not, here are people who have found up to $400-$500 pieces of opal right here. Believe it or not.
Right here?
Yeah, if you here on the ground, right where we are standing, there's plenty of opal, you start to look, you possibly don't know what it looks like,
no,
but look here. That lady was stepping on the fortune there, but she didn't realize.
All you.
That's opal, yeah? Yeah. That's opal, you just keep looking, and everybody should find some. Okay? Wonderful.
Who's got the best eyesight?
You have to find, everybody should find some. I can guarantee you there's plenty of opal.
Ivan can guarantee they'll find opal, because he put it there. They're chips of potch and colour, the leftovers from larger parcels. They're not worth the miner's time to sort through, but they might nevertheless contain some valuable pieces.
That's fortune you have, madam.
One opal chip found in Ivan's by a tourist was later polished up in the city and sold for $500. There's no question that the tourists are experiencing what the locals call opal fever. Such is the power of opal fever that they spend the next hour on their hands and knees.
I told you, in Coober Pedy, you never know where fortune lies.
But Ivan knows where his fortune lies. Upstairs in their shop, Ivan and his wife, June, cater for the tourists wanting to be guaranteed a nice piece of opal to take home.
If you're here until... Now they will give silver a gold chain. That is such a big...
Doesn't go with your other one. Pull it up.
Ivan and June are jewelers and goldsmiths by trade. They cut and polish opal and create jewelry for the local and overseas market. They can provide for all tastes and price tags, from $20 to $20,000.
Right, no worries.
But for Jim Cunningham and Jim Reynolds, making a living is not as predictable as the next tourist bus. They've made the decision that it's time to pull stakes on this claim and look elsewhere for their fortune. It's a scene they've repeated a number of times since they've been partners. On other fields like Hans Peak, Kender Flat, and Zorba's. For the younger Jim, the packing up is always depressing. Jim Cunningham is more tight-lipped. He's had to do it many times before. The blower truck engine hasn't been started for months, so a little persuasion is necessary. The 10-kilometer trip back into town is a slow one. The unwieldy blowers aren't meant to travel very far. Jim's blower will be put in for some minor repairs until they decide where next they'll commence mining. These strange machines, born and bred in the opal fields of Coober Pedy, have been described as dinosaurs of the desert. The increased cost of feeding them with diesel fuel means they might suffer the same fate. But no doubt another machine will be invented to replace them. New ideas flourish quickly in this bastion of free enterprise. Even a major part of the town's water supply is provided by private enterprise. Salty underground water is pumped under pressure through this reverse osmosis plant. The salty water is removed, leaving extremely palatable fresh water. This plant is run by two men and supplies roughly half the town's requirements. Trevor Weatherall is one of a few private contractors who deliver the water around the town. It costs about $1.50 for 50 gallons. Trevor used to be a full-time miner, but now leads a quieter life delivering water, looking after the official weather reports, and carrying out civil marriage ceremonies. Until 1977, electricity for Coober Pedy was supplied by a privately owned diesel power station or from household generators. It's now supplied from a government-run diesel power station. The pioneering spirit is well to the fore on Coober Pedy's golf course. Its fairways contain their own unique hazards to challenge the skill of the golfing miners. Jim Cunningham is well up on the championship lists. Fortunately for the keen golfers, nobody yet seems to have found any traces of opal on the golf course. Over half Coober Pedy's roughly 5,000 inhabitants come from about 30 different countries. It gives this tiny community in the middle of the Australian outback a unique cosmopolitan atmosphere. It's possible to eat Yugoslavian food, listen to Greek music, and hear only Italian being spoken, all in the same cafe. The different national groups are proud to display their cultures. At the community school, a Greek day was held by representatives of the 1,500-strong Greek community. The town contains an Italian club, a Croatian club, and a Hellenic Australian club. For Jim and Jimmo, it's back to the beginning of the opal mining process, prospecting for a fresh claim. The problem is, they've got a strip of land roughly 40 kilometres long and 15 kilometres wide to choose from. To help with their prospecting, they've called in Brian Coker, who operates a Caldwell drill. After an inspection of some nearby abandoned shafts, they've decided on this spot. Opal is completely unpredictable, and experienced miners are the first to admit that finding it is 90% luck. Sticking a pin in a map blindfolded is as good a method as any.
Well, it's as good as anywhere, you know. Can't tell from the top of the ground, so start here. Maybe blue, who knows? Maybe blue ground.
Jim pegs out a 50 metre by 50 metre claim. This gives them the right to all the opal they find under the ground. Up to four claims can be joined together and mined at one time. Once the drill gets below the surface layers of soil, they will have a better idea of their chances. If the ground turns out to be hard, blue ground, they know they'll be wasting their time.
There's a lot of few shafts being done over here, not much good. Who's to say, you know, it could be something down here. There's only one way to find out, and that's drill a hole. It can take a day sometimes, sometimes it can only take a few hours. Sometimes 2 hours, sometimes 4 hours, sometimes a whole day, sometimes 2 days.
The drilling time for a shaft depends on the hardness of the ground and the depth of the opal-bearing level. The levels of opal-bearing soil can be anywhere up to about 25 meters below the surface. The opal occurs in random pockets. Drilling is a very hit-and-miss method of prospecting. It's mostly miss, but it's the only method available. On rare occasions, miners have been known to bottom onto opal, or to miss it by only a couple of inches. Other shafts in the same area are a guide to the depth at which the opal level should occur.
I don't know, I think it's around 60 feet here, somewhere around 60 feet.
As the drill goes deeper, anticipation rises. Numerous Caldwell rigs operate on the Coober Pedy field. The hole is just large enough to lower a person down for an inspection. Drilling is expensive if you have to pay for it by the foot. Each shaft could cost around $200. Brian Coker is working with Jim and Jimmo on a percentage basis. He will take a share of whatever opal they might find in the claim, if they strike it. Brian drills cash shafts to pay for expenses, but he prefers the excitement of taking part in the gamble by working on a percentage. Like most business deals in Coober Pedy, it's all based on a handshake and trust. Running the rig is an expensive operation, especially when the bucket strikes hard rocks. This particular rig has found millions of dollars worth of opal in its time, but it's also overdue for repairs. Drill has reached the level, but by the look of the rock, Jim knows they'll be wasting their time in this spot. The Church of England's underground catacomb church takes its name after the catacombs in Rome, in which the early Christians hid. The communion table is a mining windlass and bucket. The St. Peter and St. Paul Catholic Church is also underground. The regular masses are well attended by Coober Pedy's large Roman Catholic population.
The grace and peace of God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with us.
The trend in mining in Coober Pedy is towards the larger scale operation. Bigger machines can dig further, faster, and shift more dirt. Tunneling machines are popular. Most of the machinery in this operation was manufactured by the operators themselves. A tunneling machine is lowered underground down a large diameter shaft. Once in place, it's necessary to keep it working to make the mine economical. These partners also run a Caldwell drilling rig. It's continually prospecting ahead of the tunneling machine, looking for likely directions to take the drive. No matter how elaborate the machinery, when you're near opal, the hand pick is brought out. The other major method of mining in Coober Pedy is with a bulldozer, especially where the opal level is nearer the surface. George Cooley and his partners have only recently started mining this claim. They struck good opal not long after their first cuts with the dozer. Spotters walk behind the machine, checking the broken rocks for any indications of opal. The deeper the level, the harder it is to use a bulldozer, because the dirt has to be pushed up so high. Licking the opal helps miners check if there is any good color beneath the surface dirt.
And that colour there, the one that broke in half,
yeah.
You could be probably looking at $1,000 to $1,500 an ounce for an ounce of that colour. We've got to have a lot more material yet to make a few ounces, yeah. Oh, we've got only maybe 5 or 6 ounces there, you know?
Before the opal is in a form suitable for selling, it has to be cleaned and graded. A few hours in the tumbling machine takes off the looser dirt around the opal. A series of wire mesh pans sorts the opal into different size pieces. The rock still clinging to the opal has to be carefully snipped away to show off its best colors for the buyer. At this stage, an independent valuer is often brought in before offering the parcel for sale. Mr. Jackson Liu is one of the longest established buyers in Coober Pedy. The atmosphere is informal, but the bargaining is serious. Deals are always done in cash.
So it'll be expensive. I give you 9,500 off. 9,500.
I think it's worth a little bit more, Mr. Liu. Well, do you mind having another look and if you can push the price a little bit?
Yeah. Exact figures on how much the opal business is worth to Coober Pedy are impossible to verify. Officially, it's around $20 million a year, but unofficial estimates run to as high as $100 million.
Well, I think that's reasonable, so I'll agree to that.
By the time the cut and polished opal reaches the retail end of the chain, its value has doubled or tripled. Jim Cunningham and Jim Reynolds were heading for another site they fancied. Miners call it road running. But the blue smoke from the exhaust and suspicious knocking noises from the engine were giving Brian cause for concern. He was hoping to squeeze in the partner's drilling before the rig went in for an overhaul. The oil pressure dropped alarmingly. Although they were some kilometers from their destination, Brian pulled up. He didn't want to be stuck in the desert with a completely blown motor. It looked as if the drilling would have to wait until repairs could be made. The drill motor was still operational, and Jimmo suggested they might as well put a shaft down while they were waiting for the truck motor to cool down. Though they were right next to the road and nowhere near their intended drilling site, the others agreed they might as well give it a go. The way their luck was running so far, they hadn't much to lose. Every time a new shaft is sunk, even such a wildcat one as this, the same apprehension and excitement sets in. Perhaps this will be the one that bottoms on a big strike. To everyone's surprise, the drilling went well, and the rock being brought up looked promising. Jimmo would go down the shaft to check it out.
I wonder if it's not open, isn't it? Being like that. Got a chance of getting killed or something.
What's it like?
Pot, lots of it. All the way round. There's tons of it. Pot. About 1/4 inch thick.
This was the best indication from any of the half dozen shafts they had drilled so far. A strong line of potch running around the shaft. It was just the sort of news they needed. Excitement was high. The next step was to drill another hole nearby to see if the potch was continuing to run as strongly as the indications show. The truck motor has cooled down, so Brian was willing to move the rig the few meters necessary. They had just started on the second hole when some newcomers arrived. When the newcomers began pegging out claims, a closer investigation was necessary. Perhaps they had unwittingly started a new rush.
But what did he say, found a vertical in the shaft?
In one of the shafts there.
One of the shafts. We checked nearly all of them, didn't we?
Traces in two drives, he said. Well, that's what I said, yeah.
Yeah.
But, you know, nothing exciting. And a vertical higher up in one of the shafts. But he reckons they drilled them.
Well, I thought Jimmy Lemon didn't.
So, he's going the wrong way anyway.
Yep.
Maybe it'll be bloody war, too.
War.
How many we've got three, eh?
We've got three sets, plus mine over there, so, Chrissy's.
Caked up under here anyway. So.
Yeah.
To consolidate their position, Jim, Jimmo and Brian would now peg out the four claims they're entitled to. This requires some guesswork as to where they think the best ground will be. However, having your claim legally pegged still doesn't guarantee you possession of the opal. Good opal always attracts thieves. The miners call them ratters, or the night shift.
Well, I probably started right and did the whole lot in one go, which would probably be around about 40 shots, I'd say, at a guess. And then you can see where this last part of the level here I've taken down with the jack pick. Yeah, obviously the material has stopped and they've stopped too. I think we got about 7,000 out of this drive. Well, they could have got the same amount. Could have been more or it could have been a lot less, you know. It's anyone's guess. It just come Christmas time and it was time to go away. And we just left everything, backfilled it all, so they couldn't get down the shafts. And when we come back, this is what had happened. They go down claim after claim each night, and, you know, they learn more experience than us. Because, you know, we, you know, tend to spend so much time in one spot, we get used to that spot. You know, they've got a lot of different methods, you know, of finding out what's what.
For the lucky few miners onto big strikes, it'll be necessary to stay on their claims overnight. The rest can return to the comforts of town and the nightlife. The Acropolis restaurant specializes in catering to hungry, thirsty miners looking for entertainment. It stays open till the last person leaves. Sometimes this can mean all night, especially if a lucky team of miners is celebrating. A night at the Acropolis reflects the extraordinary cultural mix of Coober Pedy. Often the audience itself provides the highlight of the evening's floor show. Once more, the news for the partners is not good. They've drilled four more shafts in different directions from the first, but they've only come up with blue ground.
No, something there.
Something funny going on, you know. There's no reason for that ground to change the blue.
It does that.
Whoa.
I don't know.
After the good showings on the first shaft, it's a bitter disappointment at Jimmo. When the drilling rig is repaired, it'll be back to the road running. Five holes and five heaps of dirt are the only results of their efforts. It's a story that's been repeated thousands of times before in Coober Pedy. The larger diameter shafts can even present a hazard to motor vehicles, especially at night. The dangers of mining are an ever-present reality hanging over Coober Pedy.
Roger 7, could you tell me what the emergency is, please?
There's a car down a shaft at Wilkins Folly, map reference V11.
The spirit of the community is shown most clearly in the work of the voluntary mine rescue squad. Members of the squad give up an afternoon every fortnight to carry out practice drills. They take it in turns to be on constant radio standby. June Radica is the radio controller for the squad.
Two receiving, June.
CY base calling mobile 9, Richard Bassett.
CY
base, calling mobile 8, Jim Reynolds.
Mobile 8 to BY base.
They have every reason to take the job seriously. They know that the next call out might be to save their own lives.
Boys, what do you say, Jim?
The teamwork is impressive. The first job is to make the area safe to work in by covering any exposed shafts. Cave-ins and shaft accidents happen a dozen or more times each year. The squad has saved many lives and prevented permanent paralysis to numerous miners and tourists. They're also prepared to handle larger emergencies, such as air crashes, which might occur in this isolated part of the country.
Nice smooth ride?
Yeah, quite enjoyable, really.
Ready, lift.
All right.
See where the head is here?
The oxygen's on the way down. Which shaft do you want the...
Okay, check. All correct? Ready?
You're right, Richard.
Lift.
Coober Pedy people have always had to rely on their own resources to provide money for essential services, such as the mine rescue squad. The four-wheel drive ambulance was bought through various fundraising activities, such as picnic race meetings and mock auctions. It's operated by volunteers. The 60-year-old Coober Pedy Progress and Miners Association raised most of its funds through its operation of the local drive-in cinema. It achieved one of the largest turnovers of films in Australia. Funds from the lucrative drive-in were the mainstay of the association's community projects, such as the local airport, road maintenance and water supply. But today, the drive-in is at the point of closure. The reason is not hard to find. Television was introduced to the isolation of Coober Pedy in 1980 via satellite. Where once people went to the drive-in or visited each other and yarned about Opal or played music, they now watch the ubiquitous glow of the TV screen. A lot of residents were upset. A petition was even circulated for the removal of the television installation. But television had another, more far-reaching impact on Coober Pedy.
The introduction of television in October 1980 has probably had the single most drastic effect on the association's finances in its 56 years of history. The drive-in theatre has gone from being one of our most important revenue providers to one of non-profitability. This loss of revenue has virtually forced the committee to stop all community expenditure except the most essential. Despite cuts in expenditure and numerous reviews of operations, we have ended the year considerably out of pocket. The introduction of legislation to allow the association to collect rates seems to be the only answer if the association is to continue to be responsible for town administration and development. The Act, if passed, will allow the association to collect rates from all allotments, whether freehold or leasehold.
The hard reality of urbanisation has come to Coober Pedy. Rates will now be levied on dugouts. The town, without planning, will need maps. Shortcuts will become streets. Streets will need names. Dugouts will need numbers. The address will no longer be simply care of Coober Pedy Post Office, but Dugout 51, Bolshevik Gully. There'll probably even be a postman. What effect this will have on the independent spirit of the town remains to be seen. There's no doubt some of its pioneering colour will be lost forever. Perhaps it was inevitable. As inevitable as men will be drawn to look for Opal. For as long as there is Opal under the desert, it will attract men to Coober Pedy to seek their fortune. Individuals looking for the freedom to pursue their own destiny in their own way. Individuals with the determination to try and try and try again. Men willing to risk years of their life in pursuit of the elusive Queen of Gems. The $1 million gamblers.